Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Natural Theology, A Biblical and Historical Introduction and Defense, by David Haines, narrated by David Colacci. Preface to the audience. I write this preface to remind myself of what I am doing here and of how this book came about. This short introduction to natural theology has been in the works for close to 15 years. I began studying Thomas Aquinas as a young Protestant pastor in a Baptist church in Quebec in about 2005. I was introduced to Aquinas, along with Plato, Aristotle, and Etienne Gilson, through the works of Norman Geisler and his four-volume Systematic Theology. I was so enamored with the works of Geisler and Aquinas that I ended up moving with my family to North Carolina, where I studied theology and philosophy under, among others, Jason Reed, Barry Leventhal, and Richard Howe at Southern Evangelical Seminary. As strange as it may seem to some, I studied philosophy to learn how better to preach the gospel. From North Carolina, we returned to Quebec City, where I completed a Ph.D. in philosophy under the renowned Thomas de Koninck. Up until this point, it never crossed my mind that there might be a significant number of Christians who seriously rejected the possibility of a natural knowledge of God independent of the Scriptures, what is traditionally called natural theology. Cornelius Van Til had come on my radar, but he and his followers seemed to me at the time to be a relatively insignificant and fanatical group within the larger Reformed family. I did not realize just how influential his work was, or would become, in Quebec. In 2011, I attended a conference in Montreal, where John MacArthur explained in a fairly dogmatic manner to a large group of church leaders that natural theology was man's attempt to get to God on his own, to secure his own salvation by relying on his own forces and powers of reasoning. He went on to explain that this doctrine was founded upon the philosophy of Aristotle as interpreted by Thomas Aquinas. I was flummoxed, and my curiosity piqued, as I had never, up to that point, read any author, at least not Aristotle, Aquinas, or any Thomistic scholar, who thought that natural theology could save anybody. So I did what any good scholar does. I broke open the books to see if what MacArthur said was true, trying to be a good Berean Christian, a la Acts chapter 17, verse 11. I thought it best to concentrate my attention, at that time, on the Reformed theologians. I began with the authors I had in my library at the time, Charles Hodge, A. H. Strong, Francis Turretin, John Calvin, and a few more. It started as a blog post. Then I read Francis Turretin's statement, in the first volume of his Institutes, to the effect that all the Reformed Orthodox affirm a natural theology, that is, a natural knowledge of God which is available to all men, both in innate ideas and through discursive argumentation. This led me down the long road that is culminated in the writing of this short introduction to the biblical and historical teaching about natural knowledge of God. Almost every section in this book was, at some point, presented in a conference somewhere in the last 7 years. Parts of this book were presented at two national Davenant convivia. This group of godly men and women has influenced both my academic and spiritual lives more than I can possibly recount here, where the debates and discussions sharpened my arguments and pointed me in new directions. Other parts were presented at Evangelical Theological Society conferences or at academic conferences in Quebec. This book is, in a sense, a summary of my research, a very short summary, which was made better through the editing work of Ansi Kamel and Reese Laverty, the hardest part probably being to convince me that, at some point, I would have to decide not to quote every Reformed theologian from the 1500s to the 1700s, and even remove some of the quotes. Gentlemen, I'm sorry. I tried. I removed so many quotes and references. It is my hope that the listener of this book will follow the references that I do provide and will discover many that I have removed or that I haven't stumbled upon yet, and maybe even take a similar journey as I did. It is a journey of discovery by which I have grown in my love and knowledge of God as both Creator and Savior. Long walks in the forests and fields with my family and friends, discovering mushrooms and flowers, chatting with a wild pheasant named Charlotte, who followed us in our walks, and watching the stars, have all driven me to worship God, to recognize His transcendent otherness and His imminent closeness. Taking those same walks with Will Pugh, talking about everything from natural theology to the difficulties of life, and books that we've never completed, but which made great points in the third or fourth chapter, reminded me that the God who is the majestic Creator is also our loving Father, who forgives our sins, overlooks our faults, and loves us through His Church. Reminiscing aside, my point is this: God reveals Himself to us in His world, in each of its elements, the natural world, human history, and even the individual human being, in His Word, and in His Church, in each of its elements, His people, the preaching of the Word, and the sacraments. Through His world, He reveals Himself as great and majestic, distinct, beyond our imagination and even our words, ineffable, immutable, eternal, omnipotent, eternal, good, true, and beautiful, but also as worthy of worship and as the judge of those who turn from Him to idolatry and evil. We are all prone to turn from God. To those who will listen, this world calls us back. We are all prone to what Stephen Charnock calls practical atheism. Natural theology, or even a nice brisk walk in the woods, is a great remedy for this spiritual sickness. Through His Word and His Church, God reveals Himself as all of this, but especially as the loving, compassionate, merciful, long-suffering, patient, gracious, Redeemer, Savior, and Lord. Divine truth, preached in word and in sacrament, reminds us that we are miserable offenders in need of daily repentance. Soli Deo Gloria. Introduction. What is natural theology? Nein, was Karl Barth's thundering response to Emil Brunner's 1934 article, Nature and Grace. The flavor of their debate can be tasted by looking not only at the title of Barth's paper itself and the title of the introduction, Angry Introduction, but also at the way Barth describes, in the preface of his article, the fact that he thinks Brunner to be on the verge of heresy. He states that Brunner's appeal to natural theology must be heartily confronted and rejected. His, Brunner's, essay is an alarm signal. I wish it had not been written. I wish that this new and greater danger were not approaching, or that it had not been Emil Brunner who had crossed my path as an exponent of that danger, in a way which made me feel that, for better or worse, I had been challenged. This debate between Barth and Brunner, and the heat it generated, contributed to the dissolution of their friendship. For Barth, there is almost no point in arguing against natural theology. To do so would be to argue against a non-existent thing. For natural theology does not exist as an entity capable of becoming a separate subject within what I consider to be real theology, not even for the sake of being rejected. All one can do is to turn one's back upon it as upon the great temptation and source of error by having nothing to do with it and by making it clear to oneself and to others from time to time why one acts that way. At the same time, on the other side of the Atlantic, another 20th-century Reformed theologian was also rejecting natural theology, albeit in a different way than Barth. For Cornelius Van Til, the problem of natural theology is that, in sum, man, regenerate or unregenerate, cannot rightly understand it without special revelation. To understand God's general revelation in the universe aright, it was imperative for man that he see this revelation in relationship to a higher revelation with respect to the final destiny of man and the universe. If then even man in paradise could read nature aright only in connection with and in the light of supernatural positive revelation, how much the more is this true of man after the fall? This claim is, as will become evident over the course of this book, the denial of what has been understood throughout church history as natural theology. This debate continues even today. Many contemporary theologians and philosophers think that the affirmation of natural theology is the rejection of Reformed orthodoxy. Richard B. Gaffin, Jr. writes, "By now, too, we should have learned that natural theology may have a place in Roman Catholic and Arminian theologies with their semi-Pelagian anthropologies and qualified optimism about the unbeliever's capacity to know God, but not in a theology that would be Reformed." For K. Scott Oliphant, the notion that some truth can be acquired and demonstrated without any need of revelation was rightly rejected during the time of the Reformation and in 17th century Protestant theology. Rather, if there is any natural theology at all, it is, Oliphant suggests, following Van Til in this, a product not of natural reason, but of natural revelation and of a regenerate mind. The 20th century rejection of natural theology by some prominent Reformed theologians was so outspoken and virulent that it has even led some Catholic scholars to assume that to be Reformed is to reject natural theology. Francis J. Beckwith, by contrast, has suggested that, though some Protestants defend natural theology, Reformed theologians either misunderstand what Aquinas is doing and end up defending something that Aquinas would have rejected, or misunderstand what Aquinas is doing and end up explicitly denying it. In both cases, of course, if Beckwith is right, a straw man has been raised and either defended or burnt to the ground. Interestingly enough, as we shall see, if one takes Beckwith's general definition of what Aquinas says about natural theology and compares it with the writings of most of the Reformed theologians from the 1500s to the end of the 1800s, we will find that they are substantially in agreement. This raises the question, why did prominent Reformed theologians in the 20th century suddenly distance themselves from their own tradition by rejecting natural theology? The question is so important that one scholar, Michael Suddeth, published a book seeking to answer it. To say that, in the last 100 years or so, natural theology has become a hotly debated subject within Protestant circles could probably qualify as one of the theological understatements of the century. With so much debate, it can often be difficult to see where the lines are, or should be, drawn. It is the purpose of this book to introduce one to the traditional Christian understanding of natural knowledge of God. To this purpose, we will begin by defining our terms. What do we mean by natural theology, natural revelation, and so on? This will be followed by a consideration of those passages of Scripture which are most often discussed in relation to natural theology. In this section, we will consider how these passages have been traditionally and historically interpreted. We will then turn to a historical overview of, first of all, what the pagans thought about God, and secondly, what the Church said about natural knowledge of God and the ability of unregenerate humans to obtain this knowledge. We will, therefore, begin with the pre-Socratic philosophers, sprinting from them through the history of Western thought and explaining the thought of important thinkers along the way. We will finish this historical survey with the Reformed theologians of the 1500s to 1700s. This will lead us, finally, to engage with a number of critiques of natural theology that have been raised since the late 19th century. It is my hope that this short treatise will provide one with a firm foothold for understanding this subject, for navigating the treacherous waters of the contemporary debate, and for situating ourselves within the historic Christian tradition. What is natural theology? The word theology comes from two Greek words, theos and logos. The word theos means God. When Westerners hear the word God, they tend to think of the God of the Abrahamic religions. Yet this word's meaning varies by culture. It does not necessarily refer to any particular God. Since this is the case, we must always qualify the term theology by designating which theology we are talking about: Christian, Jewish, Muslim, Greek, Hindu, or others. Logos also has many meanings. Joseph Owens, in The Doctrine of Being in Aristotelian Metaphysics, explains, "In the earliest Greek writers, logos means only word in the singular and speech in the plural. Its various meanings in Aristotle are listed by Bonnets under the following heads: 1. Word, language, or speech. 2. Notion or thought. 3. The faculty of thinking or reasoning. 4. Mathematical proportion, relation." In the earliest Greek writers, it simply means word in the singular and speech in the plural. In Aristotle, its use expands to include a notion or thought, the faculty of thinking, mathematical proportions or relations, as well as a definition, formula, explanation, or even a plan conceived. Martin Heidegger suggests that in the original sense of this word, there is a notion of gathering together for organization. Taking the observations of Owens and Heidegger into account, we note that even if we translate logos as speech, word, or another meaning related to thought or dialogue, we must always remember that this word implies a gathering together and organizing of objects in order to observe how they relate to one another. Together, theos and logos denote the dialogue about or the observation and organization of truth statements concerning God. In a word, theology. A theologian, then, is a strange character whose weekly occupation and lifelong vocation is to engage in dialogue about true statements concerning God. For Aristotle, theology was the knowledge of the first principle of all that exists, God. It was a knowledge that was attainable through human observation of the sensible universe. In Augustine's City of God, we find Augustine referring to a certain Varro, who used the term natural theology to describe philosophical discourse about the gods. This may be the first time that the terms natural and theology are found combined together and used to designate what, for Aristotle, was simply theology or wisdom. As we shall see, Augustine does not reject the possibility of a philosophical knowledge about God, a natural theology, but does point out that the pagan philosophers who had discovered some truths about God, especially the Platonists, allowed error to be mixed with the truths. Many Christian theologians throughout history have distinguished between what man can know of God by reason alone and what man can know of God through the inspired Word of God. Thomas Aquinas notes that metaphysics is the most excellent and certain science that man can attain through the human intellect without any super-added divine grace needed in addition to common grace in order to comprehend it. But there is a science that is superior to metaphysics, sacred theology, which is based on the Word of God. Sacred theology is superior to metaphysics because it is knowledge that comes directly from God. As such, it is more certain than human knowledge. From the time of Augustine on, natural theology has been the popular term for talking about the study of what man can know about God by reason without recourse to special revelation. One would think, then, that providing a definition of natural theology would be easy. It is not. In the late medieval period, philosophers who studied metaphysics began to say that the main subject of metaphysics were God, the soul, substance, and post-mortem life. According to Joseph Owens, Francis Bacon defined natural theology as that part of metaphysics in which we study what man can know of God by reason alone. Natural theology, broadly defined, is that part of philosophy which explores that which man can know about God, his existence, divine nature, etc., from nature alone, via man's divinely bestowed faculty of reason, unaided by special revelation from any religion, and without presupposing the truth of any religion. We must distinguish our definition of natural theology from a number of other concepts. Natural theology, so defined, is not the same as what is commonly called natural revelation. Natural revelation is to natural theology what the Bible is to biblical theology, its raw material and source data. It is, as John Calvin says, what God does when He manifests His perfections in the whole structure of the universe, and so manifests Himself daily in our view that we cannot open our eyes without being compelled to behold Him. Natural revelation is made up of the traces or fingerprints of God as seen by all men, regenerate and unregenerate, in creation. Throughout Christian history, theologians have seen natural revelation as one of the two books by which God reveals Himself, the other being the Scriptures. To illustrate the difference between these two books, consider how a work of art relates to a biography of the artist. It is commonly known that Leonardo da Vinci never signed any of his works, and yet his works not only are among the most well-known of the Renaissance, but were also revolutionary. Now, let's say that a young man brought up in our contemporary education system has never heard of or been introduced to any of da Vinci's painting. Not an unreasonable thing to imagine. Upon walking into a used bookstore, clearly lost, he sees a particularly well-done reproduction of the Mona Lisa or the Last Supper. The painting has the same effect on him as it has had on everyone since it was painted. It captures his attention. He gazes upon the painting for some time. However, after searching in vain to discover the signature of the painter, he infers that it must have been the product of blind chance, and leaves the bookstore amazed at how something so beautiful could be produced via some sort of elaborate accident. Of course, this is not what the young man does. Knowing nothing about Da Vinci, but recognizing that such a beautiful work of art could not come into existence by chance or of its own accord, the young man inquires as to the name of the artist. When he sees the painting, though he knows nothing about its creator, he is able to recognize that there was indeed an artist, and that the artist arranged the colors in just the way that he did in order to render the image in the painting. The artist is clearly intelligent, admires beauty, and is able to create beautiful things. By simply looking at the work of art, the young man is able to infer the existence of, and some basic truths about, the artist. Yet the works tell him nothing about who the painter was. Da Vinci's paintings were not signed. For that he needs some other source, perhaps the painter himself, or someone who knows him well enough to be able to identify him. Indeed, even if the young man came to know the identity of the painter, we would still require some other source than the painting itself, such as a biography, in order to learn more about what he is like. All of this is analogous to the relation between natural revelation and special revelation in our knowledge of God. Christian theology has traditionally taught that by gazing upon the cosmos we come to recognize that God, its provident creator, exists. Natural revelation, however, is not sufficient for telling us more than that God exists, something of His nature, and that God is worthy of worship. According to Christian theology, to discover that Jesus is God incarnate, that God is triune, and other truths explicitly revealed in Christian scriptures, one must have recourse to special revelation. Neither natural revelation nor its interpretation in natural theology reveals these truths. Natural theology, so defined, is also not coextensive with what some have called natural religion. Natural religion is best defined as that historical attempt, by a number of deistic philosophers, to make that which can be known of God via natural revelation into a religion in its own right. The unhelpful conflation of natural theology and natural religion has caused many people to reject natural theology out of hand, thinking that they were rejecting, as they should, some form of natural religion which is opposed to Christian religion and revelation. For our purposes, we most strongly distinguish natural theology and natural religion. Natural theology is not a religion in and of itself. It is rather a part of philosophy whose observations are integrated into Christian systematic theology, which, if separated from the special revelation of the Holy Scriptures, tends to turn into that monster which has become known as natural religion. Natural theology is not the claim that all the truths of Christianity can be proved via human reasoning without the aid of divinely inspired Scripture. In fact, traditional exponents of natural theology affirm that all specifically Christian truth claims can only be proven with the aid of the Scriptures. Indeed, natural theology does not venture to say anything about that which can be known only through divine revelation, such as that Jesus was born of a virgin, that Jesus is God, that God is triune, etc. Rather, natural theology is the philosophical study of that which can be naturally known about God without recourse to special revelation. It is worth noting here that it therefore follows that natural theology is also not coextensive with Christian apologetics. Christian apologetics is the defense of the truth claims of the Christian religion, some of which overlap with the subjects discussed in natural theology. Technically, natural theology only discusses the existence and attributes of the divine, not whether the deity discussed has revealed itself or is worshipped in any one religion. However, traditionally, Christian theologians have noted that not only do natural theology's discoveries about God support Christian claims about God, but in fact the God which is discovered through the study of natural revelation just is the God of Christianity. It is worth noting that when we use the phrases naturally known or natural knowledge of X, we are referring to those true judgments that humans possess, not through superhuman intervention or revelation, nor through human fabrication or imagination, but through reasoned observations about the sensible universe. For example, humans are part of the sensible universe, and so true judgments about humans, which are obtained through reasoned observations of humans, would count as natural knowledge. In fact, introspection, an individual human making reasoned observations about his own interior state of being, would also be considered natural knowledge. The content of this natural knowledge may be quite varied and includes not only those truths that are observed, Socrates is a man, this shape is a triangle, this animal is a cat, this animal is a sheep, but also those truths that are inferred. Socrates will die. This shape has three interior corners. This animal has narcissistic tendencies. This animal is stupid. Thus, the notion of natural knowledge cannot exclude, by definition, inferred knowledge of supernatural beings or realities, i.e., beings or realities that are not a part of the sensible universe, though the nature, or essence, of supernatural beings might limit how humans acquire knowledge about them, and how much knowledge humans can acquire about them. Natural knowledge is gained through natural human powers of cognition, and is arrived at through human observations of the universe of sensible beings and human reasoning about these observations. Having defined our terms, we turn to an examination of the biblical texts which have been traditionally understood as teaching that the cosmos proclaims the existence and nature of God to humans in a way that they can in fact understand. Part 1. The Biblical Foundations of Natural Theology. 1. The Biblical Foundations of Natural Theology. There is something ironic about a chapter bearing the title, The Biblical Foundations of Natural Theology, as it is really not possible to rightly interpret passages used to support the doctrine of natural theology without the use of natural knowledge and reason, including some truths which would typically be classified as doctrines of natural theology. Indeed, as I've argued elsewhere, it is natural theology which provides us with the truths necessary for the proper functioning of the principle of appropriate predication. This principle is what helps the interpreter of scriptures know when some attribute is properly predicated of God's divine nature, e.g., immutability, Numbers chapter 23, verse 19, and when some attribute is predicated only as an anthropopathism, an anthropomorphism, or a form of improper analogy, e.g., repentance, Jeremiah chapter 26, verse 13, King James Version. In other words, natural theology is a precondition for proper biblical interpretation. Many modern theologians, especially those associated with presuppositionalism, but also some modern Reformed theologians such as Charles Hodge, Augustus H. Strong, and Wayne Grudem, have been known to reject or reinterpret the classical attributes of God, such as impassibility and immutability, for no other reason that they are not explicitly outlined in Scripture. Some of these theologians show great confidence in their ability to properly interpret Scripture, rejecting as unnecessary and unbiblical all natural knowledge about God. For these theologians, all one needs to be orthodox is the Bible, properly interpreted. This, however, is an overly simplistic view of how one arrives at doctrinal orthodoxy. To properly interpret Scripture, as helpful as it is to have a solid foundation in theological and biblical studies, there are some more fundamental truths that the interpreter must already know. The interpreter must possess, in other words, natural knowledge. Commenting on just this point, James Barr points out that not only does the Bible have to be interpreted, but interpretation goes on within the Bible itself. Much of the Bible, perhaps all of the Bible, is the product of interpretation. But the consequence of this has not always been noticed. The more we stress the importance of interpretation, the more we render probable the influence of something like natural theology. Influenced by the dialectical theology, people have been inclined to think of interpretation as something that followed and expounded the contours of revelation without going in any way outside this narrow channel of thought. Interpretation, seen in this way, not only interprets revelation, but interprets it solely by the use of categories which themselves derive from revelation and are internal to it. Some of the peculiar contortions of modern interpretive theory are probably half-conscious attempts to demonstrate this. But it would really be very strange if there was interpretation which used no categories whatever that were external to the material being interpreted. Barr concludes, rightly, that even if there is no natural theology in the Bible at all, but only revelational theology, it cannot produce a total picture of God except through the activity of the theological interpreter. But that interpreter must use his own thoughts, reason, instincts, and experience in order to grade, to select, to bring together, to order, and to raise to higher levels the material with which he or she works. The interpreter will have to draw conclusions from the Scripture which itself does not make express, and this drawing of conclusions will depend on the categories, methods, and anterior preferences of the interpreter. Thus, the theologian who fully denies natural theology may nevertheless be constructing an idol out of scriptural materials just as much as the natural theologian is constructing an idol out of other materials. Indeed, even the most basic attempt to interpret Scripture requires, as a precondition, that the interpreter be in possession of a number of important types of natural knowledge: acquired linguistic knowledge, experience and knowledge of the sensible world, philosophical or theoretical knowledge, natural knowledge of the divine nature, and the very hermeneutical principles that we so meticulously apply to Scripture in order to arrive at biblical teaching. Interestingly enough, we are not the first to notice the major role that natural knowledge plays in the founding and forming of Christian doctrine. the comments of B.B. Warfield in his article, The Idea of Systematic Theology, are especially helpful. Rather than natural theology, he uses the term apologetical theology, but in Warfield's use of this term, their meanings are synonymous. Warfield states that apologetical theology prepares the way for all theology by establishing its necessary presuppositions, without which no theology is possible: the existence and essential nature of God, the religious nature of man, which enables him to receive a revelation from God, and the possibility of a revelation and its actual realization in the Scriptures. Warfield says essentially the same thing in his article, The Task and Method of Systematic Theology. The task of apologetical theology is to discern whether such a being as God exists needs to be ascertained, and if such a being exists, whether he is knowable, whether such creatures as men are capable of knowing him, and if so, what sources of information concerning him are accessible. That which natural or apologetical theology demonstrates, according to Warfield, just are naturally known truths about the sensible universe, human nature, and the divine nature. The role of apologetical theology within a wider systematic theology, according to Warfield, is to lay down those truths of natural knowledge that are necessary for both the truth of fundamental Christian doctrines and our comprehension of them. Warfield elaborates on this point by noting three major presuppositions that are held by those who engage in exegetical, biblical, historical, practical, and systematic theology, presuppositions that are established and proved by natural or apologetical theology. The first presupposition is the affirmation that God is and that he has relation to his creatures. Warfield shows the importance of this presupposition as follows. Were there no God, there could be no theology. Nor could there be a theology if, though he existed out of relation with his creatures. The whole body of philosophical apologetics is therefore presupposed in and underlies the structure of scientific theology. The second presupposition is the affirmation that man has a religious nature, that is, a nature capable of understanding not only that God is, but also, to some extent, what he is. The third is the affirmation that there are media of communication by which God and divine things are brought before the minds of men, that they may perceive them, and in perceiving, understand them. It seems evident, therefore, that proper biblical interpretation and orthodox doctrinal formulation are not possible without some natural knowledge, especially natural knowledge of God. Therefore, it seems that we are warranted to say, 1. That it is not possible, without some natural knowledge, to rightly divine the Word of God. 2. That the principle of appropriate predication is not applicable to Scripture without some prior natural knowledge of the divine nature, human nature, and the created universe. And 3. That therefore it is impossible, without natural knowledge, to determine and articulate what one must believe in order to be an Orthodox Christian. This natural knowledge is something to which every human being has access by the very fact of being alive and being able to use his senses to comprehend the created universe. This knowledge includes introspection, learning a language, learning to read, etc., all things which give the individual human being every tool he needs to be able to properly interpret the Scriptures without having to appeal to an infallible magisterium, such as that of the Roman Catholic Church. It should come as no surprise, then, to realize that the Scriptures not only assume that one possesses the various elements of natural knowledge that were mentioned earlier, but they also explicitly state that man possesses natural knowledge, specifically natural knowledge of the divine nature.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.